Ayo, what's good, everybody, and welcome back to Classic Quest on its proper Friday day. It's your boy HSR.
And your boy Chris Chrome.
And I'm Bonnie.
Wait, who the fuck's Bonnie?
I'm pretty sure she's your girlfriend.
Ah, it's true. Hi, baby.
Hi.
And Bonnie and I went to go see Straight Outta Compton last year, and it resulted in this.
Back. Gonna hit the Alpine. Play. Bumping new shit by NWA. It was Gangsta Gangsta at the top of my list. Then I plugged my old shit and it was something like this. Who's down the six in my 6'4"? Jogging the bitch. Laugh on the hoes.
What?
Pretty entertaining, right?
I fucking loved it. So far, it's gotten a great success rate with everybody I've shown it to at work. So we thought we'd share it with the internet. And in light of that, we got to Straight Outta Compton on the list of reviews. Whoops, I took your thunder, Chris. But you guys knew what album it was. It said it right there. It's in the thumbnail. Before we get there, what's more important than the album is first, Chris, when did you first encounter NWA?
Actually, I encountered NWA a couple years back when I heard Fuck the Police, I heard Straight Outta Compton. I heard, I actually did run into Dopeman, a friend of mine showed it to me. So
a couple years back.
How
did you get there? Who introduced you to it?
My boy Dan, actually, we were just chilling at his place doing, you know, we were making beats on our own. He has a machine, whatever. And he just started playing it and we started sampling some of their tracks just to get onto it. And it was pretty cool. It was pretty interesting. It was a different vibe, actually. It was funny to see that we were sampling them into.
So, Bonnie, when did you first hear about NWA?
Well, I've heard about them, but I didn't actually know anything about them at all until.
She does not know a fucking thing about rap before I met her.
No. Well, that's not true. I knew some things.
She knew the appropriate
songs. Radio songs.
She knew all the songs that every white person who doesn't like rap knows, like Gangster's Paradise and fucking Baby's Got Back and a few other ones.
But I've surprised you with some of the songs that I know.
Yes, she actually, Pharoah Munch was on her list.
Yep,
like,
yep.
But,
who?
We'll get there. We'll get there. This
you.
Is a classic journey
you.
We're on.
Where first came across NWA mostly when you introduced them to me.
It's probably true. We had many moments of, how the fuck are you dating me? And you don't know what the fuck. I make rap music, baby. Yeah. How do you not know what? This is embarrassing. I've started a new campaign and these are songs you have to know. Or you will embarrass
me
in public.
Well, I'm learning them, and I think they're great. I'm enjoying the experience of listening in on everything that you're listening to.
So people out there with the closed mind of the internet, this lady had a closed mind to the hip-hop genre, and as we go on this quest, she's opening up to new experiences. I found NWA back in the day because every white fucking person who likes rap music fucking sings Fuck the Police, the whole first verse with Ice Cube, and then it just kind of ends. But I know countless people who know it by heart, so it's almost like you got made fun of a bit for not knowing it back in when I was in stage. When I got into like YouTube back in 2006, I discovered NWA and a whole bunch of other shit. So I've pretty much had a couple of their bangers on my phone on and off my whole life. Well, my whole adult life. So Chris, what's the name of the album we're reviewing today?
Oh, well, the name of the album is NWA Straight Outta Compton. I think that was pretty clear.
Actually, I think the artist is NWA, which stands for Word We Can't Say With Attitude. What's the name of the album?
The name
Straight Outta Compton.
That's right.
That's also the name of that biopic y'all should see. And the Tupac biopic's coming, and we're super excited about that. It's called All Eyes on Me, which just happens to be the name of another album we reviewed on the Classic Quest. Okay, we'll move into it.
Coincidence? I don't think so.
So, what do you think of the name? How does that, like, strike you when you first hear it as the name of an album? Which is a harder thing, because we've all heard the song, I'm sure, but...
Well, you know how, like, nowadays it's about... Well, from where we come from, right in Montreal, it's always about putting it on the map. I feel like writing the album's name as Straight Outta Compton, it's like putting Compton right on the map. That's what they were...
Let me add some context. Montreal has this weird fragmented hip-hop scene that pretends like it's a super great thing. But, like, there is, like, 47 kings of NDG, the borough I live in. There's, like, 47 kings of Lachine. Everybody's trying to be the best of everything. Like, it's, like, Harlem and stuff. And
everybody wants to be the best.
And, well, it's just a strange emulation of other things. So I can see where you're coming from
but,
in light
of
the context.
But, you know, with that ideology behind it, it's still...
No, I am...
Back then, you were trying to get big, right? Everybody
for
was
real.
Trying to go out.
Yeah.
So putting that on the map,
And I don't want to like, come off like I'm a hypocrite or something. On the back of my album cover that just popped up here, it's the first time anyone's really seen it. You'll notice it says St. Jacques and Elmhurst, the corner I lived on while I recorded that album. So, yeah, that shit's coming this year, but I understand it, and I really love the title Straight Outta Compton. For me, it's like...
Yeah, represent.
It's basically as hip-hop as you can fucking be, as far as I ever understood it.
No, but I mean, as well changing an era and changing and bringing a new style is what these guys did. I mean...
Okay, hold
putting
on.
Putting that...
Hold we on. Can't, Bonnie's here. We can't just talk the whole time and pretend she's not in the room, bro. Sheesh, gotta protect the lady.
Why? You can still let him have his opinion. I thought that the name of the record was good. You know, it does put them on the, like, on the map, just like you were saying.
It was a really effective campaign, ultimately, eh?
Yeah, I mean, and it made people want to be from Compton.
Hold on. It doesn't just make people want to be from Compton. The city of Compton...
It draws attention. It's going to create Compton, tourism.
The city of Compton once hearted one of my tweets.
Pretty good moment.
Imagery behind the art of the album cover, which is what I wanted to ask you about.
Let's
what did
talk
you
about
think about that?
Well,
I found cool how they did it. And if you were to guys catch the previous podcast, Public Enemy.
I have to say that it was a different thing. So Public Enemy has it all at this downward going up angle. This is like literally the camera is below them like that. And they're looking down at it.
Yeah.
But you know what I never noticed before?
What?
Eazy's got a fucking gun.
How did you miss that?
I've never really looked at the cover. It's like I've never cared.
I mean,
Eazy, he just has the gun pointed at it. This is some,
but
like,
isn't that who Eazy-E
is?
Like,
of the being the voice of the streets, right? This mm-hmm. is a move, right? I don't think that we can just look at it like this is some typical, he's a gangster selling it. No, they were trying to sell some reality, and this is their reality. And that's how I at least perceived the
no,
gun.
No, for sure. But I mean, in his reality, the gun is there.
So the first song is Straight Outta Compton.
I wanted to know, what did you think about that song?
I really liked it.
Did you?
I did. I think it was a really great,
did you
hard,
think...
you know, it really hooked you into the album. It was a really great start. It talked about their life. It introduced each of the members of the crew and, you know, just kind of told you a little bit about each one. Explained what NWA
I got stands a for. I got a serious question, Chris.
Mm.
Have you ever heard it put so nice?
No, I don't think I have.
Please,
I don't think I have.
Maybe, please.
This is like the alternate version. In like a,
like
in
I went,
like a parallel
I went,
universe of
hold
what
on,
this
like,
song
like
is.
My description is like, this shit's hard as fuck. And then she's like, it's a very pleasant experience. They came, they're telling you about their neighborhood. Like, grandma was over there with some tea and crumpets. Like,
I mean, but actually, though, I kind of agree with her niceness, only because that, did you guys check the music video?
Yeah.
Right? For me, it was completely hard to see them try to be hard.
It was like
okay. I look at
they're
them,
so
and they're
young.
So young,
they're
and
so
I'm like,
young.
No. For me, it was like, look, you watch, like, Ice Cube now, and he's got his two-step, and then when they dance, they're all on beat and shit.
Yeah.
These guys had no rhythm.
Nothing.
They could not. And then the cuts were so corny. The editing was so corny.
But, I mean, that was good for back then.
And I have to say...
Right? Like...
No, I don't know if that was good for back then. Slick Rick had good for back then. This was, like, bootleg budget for back then, bro.
Okay.
I like the fact that they're in Compton, that the cops show up and fuck around. But, man, they're, like, it was just so corny. I had a lot. I don't think I will ever watch that video again.
But all their videos are a little
No. We can talk differently about the other video we'll get to. But this one was off. But the rapping... ridiculous.
No.
I do not. I am not an Eazy-E fan, folks. So when we get to Eazy-E and this album, I might not have opinions that internet haters will have. So feel free to tell me all about why Eazy does it and shit is the greatest shit you've ever heard. I know that's a different album. Meantime, Straight Outta Compton, he actually was dope. I thought MC Ren was enthralling. Ice Cube, it's like it's
Ice
hold
Cube.
On. Can I just ask the very first question? Who is MC Ren?
Okay.
I feel like he's, like, I've never heard of him before.
Okay, right.
At
we
least
never
some
even,
of the other guys I've
okay,
heard
let's
of.
Okay, let's take like a little tangent then, and we'll just talk about NWA's group members. So, this is
like,
back.
And he was, you know.
He's good. Well, he the question. Let
okay,
him answer
okay, okay,
you.
Okay, go,
I pulled
go,
out
go,
the
go.
Phone. I got the notes.
Yes, guys, sorry, we're still on our phones. It's coming.
Yeah, dude. Like, we're talking months, though, to manage your expectations. I'm not that rich yet. But let's talk about the members of NWA. Now, as we said last week, this was at a time when hip-hop rolled in crews. And inside of that crew, you would have your producers. Everyone was just right?
Your entourage.
And we'll get to the album that changed that.
But it's not just entourage.
It's like the whole act.
You've got your DJ, you've got your producer, you've got your rappers.
So in NWA, you have Eazy-E, who is the bankroll / rapper / guy who is the legitimate life of NWA.
General Badass.
He's like the face. He's the face.
He has the highest pitched whiny rap voice. I do not get why people fucking like him, but I get it. I get
it's the same reason why people like Danny Brown.
No, Danny Brown I like. But this guy, it's like...
He has a unique sound.
Look, he does. And I respect how real he was. And I guess if you want to... He fucked a lot of women and a lot of things about him are interesting and admirable. But I don't like his rap that much. I'm sorry.
It's not okay.
And then Ice Cube. Oh my gosh, Ice Cube's ridiculous.
Ice Cube's dope. Ice Cube's fucking dope. Then you got Dr. Dre. Yeah.
These are
all people we know.
Then you got MC Ren. Okay. Because MC Ren deserves credit here. So when we talk about the songwriters on the album, you're gonna notice that pretty much two names appear on any song that these guys are on, and that's Ice Cube and MC Ren. Eazy-E didn't write a fucking lyric on this song. He has a verse. It was written by Ice Cube. He did his verse. MC Ren did his verse, probably. And then the DOC, who is another rapper of the era, was involved in the writing of this song. I don't know whose verse he wrote. Wikipedia was clearer on other songs. So MC Ren is a rapper throughout the 90s. You don't know about him because he was never quite as big as any of the other guys in NWA. In the same way that who the fuck is DJ Yella, right? Because DJ Yella and Dr. Dre represent the production side of it, so they made the beats.
But I feel like at least I've heard the name DJ Yella. Yeah, because you watched Straight Outta Compton. MC Ren.
He was in the movie.
No, even before that.
Okay, but I'll be honest, I knew what a DJ Yella was simply because he was in the group. Outside of that, I didn't know who he was until
pretty much
Straight Outta Compton came out. Yeah. And then you started watching, he's in all these interviews all of a sudden. DJ Yella and Dre did the beats, and then the real question is, who the fuck is Arabian Prince? Because, like, if you check the album credits,
He's on one track. One track.
And barely on the one track, but he's not a guest feature like the DOC is. He's credited as a member of NWA, which I imagine he was, but he's part of the group.
He would be part of the entourage, I would assume.
No. He was,
but what did he do?
He was, like, a member of the group, the way everyone else was.
Wait, was he even in the movie?
I think he showed up for 6 seconds, but the movie glossed over people.
Okay.
And shit, like, if you really look into it, there's some stuff. There's even a movie that was kind of made against Straight Outta Compton, telling the perspective of the women involved, and I look forward to watching that at some point. I believe it's fully available on YouTube, but I'm not...
I haven't heard about that.
So, anyway, to answer your question, MC Ren is a guy who was part of NWA, and as is the case with many groups like this, certain members get heard of by white girls from the country, and other members don't get heard of by white girls from the country.
Yeah, but it's not just me. Have you ever heard of them before?
I've heard of DJ Yella.
MC Ren had a solo career in the 90s. Continue with Straight Outta Compton talk just a little bit. I think the song is ridiculous. The beat is the most powerful thing. I think that I have, in fact, witnessed the strength of street knowledge. Thank you. I fucking really, it is the best album opener I have heard in the 20 album reviews we've done collectively on this channel. It is the best one. From the second it starts, you just feel adrenaline.
It's the deepness of the intro. I like the deepness of the intro, how Dre just goes and says, you're about to witness the power of street knowledge. I apologize. Don't quote me on that.
Motherfucker right here.
I love how he does that because of the fact that it's like it makes you want to listen and it gives you that extra edge to listen to the intro.
It's a context for the album, not just the song. It's like the whole album is this. I digress. 5 on 5, absolute banger. I kept it plused on Spotify.
Absolute 5 on 5 for me as well.
And I also gave it 5 on 5. And all I have to say is, damn, that shit was dope.
Chris, what was your quote of the song?
I don't have a quote of the song.
Fucking guy. What did you give it?
I gave it a 5 on 5.
Ah, what a good start. Unlike like some of the other reviews where we just can't agree, but it's a good start.
Look, it was really good. The thing is, this album over the other albums is I did get to listen to Dre's newer stuff. I did listen to Ice Cube's stuff. So going back, it was a little easier for me to be like, hey, it's pre-Cube. Oh, it's pre-Dre. Let me ask you a question. Yeah.
Have you ever really considered that the same guy who did Fuck the Police also wrote, you can do it, put your back into it. I can do it, put your ass into it. I can't remember the name of the song, but it's the corniest fucking song ever. And then when you're like, what the fuck happened to you, Q? But then he came back, man, because like, Go to Church is wicked. Sick Dem Youngins on it's wicked. I fucking still like Ice Cube to this day. Profoundly wise man, I will never stop saying good things about him. Bonnie dear, what is the next song?
Well, it is Fuck the Police.
Fuck the police, coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad cause I'm brown. And not the other color, so police think they have the authority to kill a minority.
What?
Fuck the police.
Bonnie, why do you say it so weird?
Well, that's how it's spelled. I'm saying it phonetically. Okay.
Alright.
Fuck the police.
Okay, so what did you think of Fuck the Police coming straight from the underground? It's like I can't even say the name of the song without saying the next line. Like, it's impossible.
Well, I'd had heard the song before, but I had never heard, like, the intro, like, the court scene.
What about thing? The NWA is in full?
Yeah, I had never heard that before, so that
I actually never heard
a
that
new
either.
Experience huh? for me.
Am I the only one who's listened to, like, Fuck the Police back in the day?
Well, I heard it, but I, like, heard it, like, never really heard that intro.
So, I thought it was good. Again, a great follow-up song. Not really, like, strong. It told a message. It was all about defending black people and what was going on against them, fighting against the police. And it was basically a civil war between...
I have to so disagree with, like, that, right?
Why? Now,
if we're talking about the beginning of the song at Ice Cube, I'm with you. Ice Cube dropped it. But when you got MC Ren bragging about being sneaky about committing crimes, and it's a little hard to be like, well, okay, the police should be bothering you because you're apparently a sneaky criminal. Yes. I'm sorry, Mr. Ren, but as much as I would like to empathize with your cause, you're not making it easy, sir.
I mean, I think that's a little bit...
And then if Eazy-E's really the dope man, it's hard to empathize.
Yeah, but then it's also kind of like, which came first, the chicken or the egg? It's like, are they bad because they're in the hood?
How is it Ice Cube is able to be so I'm willing to get behind him and riot, and then MC Ren just drops he's a criminal? But it's the way he does it, he's like...
You have to express yourself.
We're not there yet.
So many puns. But the thing is that it doesn't seem to be so much as fuck the police as much as like, fuck you, let me sell drugs, or fuck you, let me
do,
you know?
It's like...
But they're also saying that all black people were being targeted by the police, but not all black people are bad.
Yes, Ice Cube is saying that.
Ice Cube is absolutely saying that.
Yes. MC Ren and Eazy-E are like, fuck with me and I'll kill you. Yes. That's basically what they're saying. And if you're like, fuck with
having guns in like the car.
In the verse. No, in the verse themselves, there's a gunshot that goes off in MC Ren's verse that nothing goes off in Ice Cube's verse. Look at the verses themselves.
It's like when Ice Cube's like, I got a shot off. And it's like, bodies get... You're like, yeah, I know. Like, we know that you're just talking hard.
He has a gun, and he's a general badass. Again, Ice Cube, I can back him up. You know, he seems like a pretty, like...
Yeah, not when he came out with Straight Outta Compton.
A tough character. Mister, are we there yet?
Well...
That's after, dude.
We all grow up. He wants to be a good father.
That's fair.
Look, it's not so much that... The song is directed towards the cops.
It's just that, like, the quality of what Ice Cube brings to the table is a 5 on 5. Yeah. And then instantly MC Ren and Eazy-E just don't deliver that same message even. The same prowess.
I think it's more about their pride of being what they want to be. Exactly. You know? But that's not what the song should be about.
Whereas Ice Cube's verse is about the clear police brutality. It's because I'm brown.
Yep.
Other colors don't experience that. And I have... Amazing. But for real, that song's a 4-on-5 to me. Like, Fuck the Police is not a song I can finish.
I think that if Ice Cube were able to just do the entire track, that would be a 5-on-5.
You know what? Yeah.
No hate. No hate, right? Like,
Ice Cube's verse is one of the best verses on the album. It is one of the greatest rap verses, like, fucking ever, this Fuck the Police verse. But the rest of the song, I can't finish it. I can't get... Easy E's verse is awful to me. No, I do not
Easy
like it.
Easy E's just it's boring.
Not awful to me. I recognize it's not a terrible verse. It's just, compared to Ice Cube, it's like, okay, whatever.
That's why Ice Cube starts the song, because he's like the, boom, here it is.
He took the Tupac approach to write songwriting, whereas...
That's smart, tactical-wise, so that people listen to you know only that.
That's where I was going. That's the Tupac approach, whereas the Biggie approach is leave it to the end.
I feel like that's a little bit of a waste of a beat, though. Like,
I don't agree with that.
No, but think about it. Like, if we're agreeing that MC Ren and AZE didn't really, like, do the beat justice compared to for what it said and what the song says, I feel like Ice Cube could have just done the whole track, which now it's like you're only on the first part, right? And people are only going to really listen to the first verse.
But if you...
I mean, unless you like
actually,
MC
we'll
Ren,
get to that in
know?
The next
like,
song. We'll get to that in the next song a little bit, because I don't know that that would have happened. It was a really hard verse, but would he have really delivered? What if he wrote all the... He was involved in the writing. This song was...
True.
Actually, let's double-check who wrote this. Hey, here we go. Ice Cube wrote Ice Cube's verse, and MC Ren wrote MC Ren and Eazy-E's verse. And as a result, the same writer wrote the same two verses I wasn't a big fan of. Now, does that make them bad? No. There are a lot of people who
different
are going to listen to that song and appreciate those verses as more relatable.
True. Yeah.
I'm more of an Ice Cube type of life, so I'm going to relate with the way he sees things better. Say 4-on-5 because I can't finish the song, but it's the best start.
Bonnie, what'd you give it?
I also gave it a 4-on-5. I thought it is an epic song. It's great. It tells a story about what's happening. But I did find the sound or the beat or something kind of annoying. So that's why I detracted from the point.
I feel like that was...
Is there any particular sound that you didn't like, or is it just the entire general beat?
Well, I guess it just got annoying after a while.
Okay.
I felt like that with most of Public Enemy, so I can respect that.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And you?
I gave it a 4-on-5.
Fair enough.
It was just... Look, the song's really great.
We talked enough about that song.
But the next song...
Gangsta.
Ice Cube will like to say that I'm a crazy motherfucker.
Anger Alert, that's all I can say. This is it, man. Like I didn't know this song before I saw the Straight Outta Compton movie, and then when they perform this song in that concert scene, and then you hear that, if you don't like how I'm living, well, and the crowd just goes fuck yeah. Like, for me, those are the best moments in music, when you can create that kind of an experience. And the whole song is just bars for days of how
it's really fucking
ruthless.
Tight,
and gangsta they are. I don't know, man. Ice Cube killed it, but that's like three Ice Cube verses in a row. And be honest, like, it at the end of it, like when Eazy-E does jump on, you're kind of happy Eazy-E jumped on and it wasn't a fourth Ice Cube verse, because as much as it's great, it's a lot of the same thing for three verses flow wise and shit. Honestly, I love it, man.
Although I mean, I guess it depends on how you look at it. I preferred having Eazy off of it. I think that if Eazy wasn't on it, I think I'd like it more if he just did the three verses and ended it, not drop a fourth verse.
I disagree.
Personally.
I like the way it changes. I like the way it just flips into, I'm Eazy, you the one they're talking about.
Well, yeah. He always makes
really
an
cool,
entrance.
Man. Not always. There's entire tracks on this album without him. And then there's that sample they keep using of him throughout the album. But, ultimately, Gangsta is one of those songs I listen to on the way to work because I fucking like it. It's been on my phone for ages. I can't get enough of it. I think I know most of it by heart right now.
Dope. What'd you give it?
Fucking 5-on-5. I really like this song. Wow. Like, it's not just like, oh, I discovered. No, this is a banger, man. This is like a wake up in the morning, drink some coffee, listen to some Gangsta. Because you're
the
type of cracker that's built to last. Yo, if you fuck with me, I'll put my foot in your ass. I don't give a fuck, Chris.
That's the one that goes, it's not about a salary, it's all about reality?
Yep.
Yeah.
That is the one. I like that.
Does the whole tone not just change on the song?
No, I like that about it. I've always liked the song. I just don't like Eazy.
Look, man, he's easy either one they're talking about.
No, good. He still made the song get a 4 on 5 for me.
Look, man, Levi's and whatever jeans is his only disguise.
Aight. More with the song.
I fucking really like it, man. It's too good. It's so fun. It's like, I can just picture them all cruising down the street. That song was being made. It was an amazing... 5 on 5.
Bonnie, what did you give it?
I gave it a 4 on 5. So I thought it was really good. That it...
Woman, you're on the cush tonight.
Shh. Let me talk.
Are you throwing shade, Holden?
Yeah, are you throwing it at me?
I am throwing fucking shade.
Please do not throw it at me.
We were having a good congruency of our grades, and you ruined it.
Well, that's okay. So they talked a lot about the thug life and about being a gangster. And so I get it that they're trying to explain it and they're saying this is what it's like and how it happens and, the things that you have to do and, it sucks and whatever. But it's, like, hardcore and badass at the same time. And it's kind of like, well, is it really necessary to, like, tell everybody about it? Like, we get it. We kind of know what's going on. It's like... We get it. You're being very, very violent, and it's not that necessary. I don't know. Is for me, like, why you gotta be so violent?
Because that's the reality.
He's in love.
It's not about his salad. It's about reality, baby.
And, like, he keeps reiterating that he's, you know, a crazy motherfucker. He said it in another song as well. And, you know, it's
crazy,
like,
motherfucking name, Ice Cube. Ice Cube is crazy as fuck.
Wait. Have you seen him in interviews? Do you see when he looks at you? Do you not see the eye face?
Did you see him on Ellen?
Yes. Like, he looks mad all the time. He looks like he's ready to.
Yeah.
Hold on.
And another thing.
Ice Cube?
And another thing. Okay, so he talks about how badass and ruthless and, like, you know, everything that he is, and then he's, like, built to last, and he's gonna kick everybody's ass and kill you and blah, blah, blah. And then in the song, he just lets a guy go. I'm like, what? Like, are you kidding me? He's singing, and then he's got some guy, and then he just lets the guy run off. And I'm like, and how lazy can you be? Like, you're not even sticking to your
word. Wait, I just want to say something. I'm pretty sure he turns around and goes, I knew I had to smoke his ass at that point.
Yeah,
like,
he
got away, and then he's like,
didn't.
I
didn't.
But then he's implying that in the future, in a drive-by-like setting, he will proceed to live up to this.
Yeah, but then he's got to find him and those others.
That's,
yeah,
but
that's, right,
but that's part of the reality.
See, the thing is you're not thinking like a criminal now, baby. You can't just blast the motherfucker in plain sight.
But he had the opportunity.
Sight.
It was right
but
there.
Opportunity.
No, he got away and jumped in the car and drove off. That's why he couldn't get
and
him that time.
And
he drove off.
You just proceed into a high-speed chase immediately. As much as you don't give a fuck.
I'm pretty sure he says he just runs away. I'm pretty sure he says he just
runs
away.
But look,
away.
Even if he runs away, just because somebody strikes you, you have to bust the cap in their ass. But that doesn't necessarily mean in that moment. See, you have to be a strategist, as the 90s hip-hop will inevitably teach us.
Okay, let me take out my little notebook here and write down. Well, anyway, so
you
I
guys
just
see
said
what
that.
I have to put up with?
And then they both said,
see what I
got to
put up
last.
With?
And we all know what happened to Eazy-E, so fail.
you did not just okay, I mean, I know the gut.
Look, wow.
There's nothing going back. There is no going back.
Well, it's true. And built to last. Okay, Ice Cube, you are lasting, but I mean, I don't know. He wasn't even sticking with his word.
We have to agree with you.
It was
you.
A good song.
I agree
just
with
like,
you about how Eazy-E failed to last because of his promiscuity. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, Ice Cube managed to build a legacy that is far too profound for this to be a hypocritical song while retaining his gangsta.
Well, I just meant like his word in this particular song.
I sometimes bump this song by him where he describes how he now gets the youngins to do it for him because he's a general up top. He has built
a
last.
Yeah, they talk about being in the army and stuff in a few different songs as well.
Okay, let's talk about If It Ain't Ruff.
The dirt on your face to cause acne. It's ridiculous thinking that you can jack me. This is the round where the punch will go until your HEAD that's known as a blow.
This is the first song I didn't know. Okay, like I knew the first three. Let's be real. Like reviewing
Fair.
It so far is like reviewing shit that I've listened to for a decade, except for Gangsta Gangsta. But let's say that's for a year. Then we got to this, and I don't think I've ever listened to an MC Ren song before.
Fully.
Nope.
Like it's just Ren.
Like it was dope.
It was so good.
It was
the wicked
dope.
And wicked. The fucking wicked and
question,
and wicked. And you're just like,
does MC Ren chop?
Like, I don't know if I would call that chopping.
Well,
but
no, I mean, at one point, it was kind of like a Slick Rick type of move. It was like a little do-do-do-do-do. I was like, hey,
I was just like, the flow was really distinct, and the wordplay was like, and I play with the rhymes because the rhymes are what I play with, and you're like, but he kept doing it in a way where it didn't feel lazy like modern rap does it.
No, but you know what? Or, I think it was finally one of the songs that he got to actually express himself in it, like a full track of just MC Ren. Like, I find, as an artist, it's different.
Truly, like, next level fantastic to me. I was highly unexpecting it. I unplussed it, but having heard it again in a little sample, I'm going to replus it because it's actually fucking great.
No,
like,
it's worth listening to.
Yeah.
It makes me want to go and check out his album, The Villain in Black, which I don't know if it made our list. And if not, I think I'm going to put it on the list because I am so curious to know what an album of this guy would sound like. I don't know if I'm enthused, but this song mesmerized me. All right.
Well, I thought it was very good. I gave it a 4.5 on 5. It was surprisingly great considering I didn't even know who this guy was. If it ain't rough, it ain't him. So I learned that. So he's, again, another badass.
They're pretty much all badass, Bonnie. I mean, come on.
Yeah, I guess they all have to say it again. Oh, this is where he talks about being a top-ranking official, I believe it is, that he references. And Ice Cube had also talked about being a captain. So they're all, like, wanting to be, like, high up
but
in the army,
I think,
in control,
like,
running stuff.
Baby, it's part of the gang structure, too. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
I don't
know that. I think it's part of just being in, like, saying that you're higher up and you're better. Like,
or that
just
you
like
think
a
like an officer and not a basic soldier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Strategies and shit. Either way, I fucking really dug this track. It was a straight 5 on 5 to me.
Yeah.
Oh, well, no, you said 4 on 5. So
4.5.
I actually gave it a 4.5 as well.
What's wrong? How did it lose points? What was off about this song?
There was nothing off about it.
This is better than Fuck the Police.
Wow.
Okay, you're getting mad.
Okay, it's pretty good.
Look at this.
Look, if it ain't rough.
It's different. It's true.
The only reason why I didn't give it a 5 on 5 is just because there's some parts where I kind of fell off. Like, the entire structure of it is nice.
Objectively, there are a couple points on the flow where it feels like he did not do that verse in one take. I can tell you that, sir.
But that's fair. No, I gave him that. That's fair. I don't think anybody could do that verse in one take.
I can do that verse in one take.
Oh, okay.
But, no, but, like, it has a lot to do with the fact that we can now look at lyric sites and read it, and our techniques have evolved over time.
Fair.
But, like, back then, it never would have even considered that they had to do it in one take, you know? Like,
fair. But, I mean, there is some parts where I kind of was like, I was on that little track and then,
Never fell off. It was perfect.
I don't know. Not like fell off, just a little dip down.
Like,
and I was
it's
like,
not better than Gangsta Gangsta, but it's as good as, if not, like, a little worse, but as good as Gangsta Gangsta.
But,
yo, what's the next song, Mr. Chrome?
The next song is Parental Discretion is Advised.
I'll be what is known as a bandit. You gotta hand it to me when you truly understand it. Because if you fail to see, read it in Braille, it'll still be funky. So what's next is the flex of a genius.
I wonder.
And is it spelt with a Z? It's spelt wrong.
That's a Z to you Americans.
Yes.
And I wonder how closely linked this song actually was to the process, or the NWA was to the process of getting the sticker put on the albums. I bet they were part of it. This album had a lot of cuss words.
Yes, yes.
And I have to agree, when I heard this song, it's probably good to have some discretion from parents and their advisements before younger minds might listen to this, because they present some very foul profanity.
Well, I mean, they are discussing how they are. It's kind of like they're portraying that they're better and everything, and how they're doing life and how they're succeeding. And
yeah.
I mean, I agree. Like,
fuck the DOC, man. This that plug was awful.
I thought the DOC was good. I don't know who he is, but I thought he was good.
I hated his, like, promo for his upcoming album and shit, and, like, the way he did it. It just felt so cheeky.
My favorite
out of place.
Part
I mean,
was the cameras.
That's
flashing.
Dre. That's not the DLC.
Oh, that was the Dre part? Okay. Well, I like that line because it sounded like the camera's flashing.
I felt that Dr. Dre had the sloppiest Dr. Dre verse I've ever heard. Like, there were so many times this flow was off.
Dre was terrible.
Whoa.
Like, she just says it so bluntly.
Like,
and
first,
then,
wait, what happened to the whole niceness?
So
and then MC Ren,
well,
it wasn't quite as good as, like, let's say it wasn't rough enough for what I'd come to expect from MC Ren.
Yeah. I don't know. The entire song, it wasn't bad.
Then Ice Cube brought it back to life, like,
because you killed it. Know he means but every you know what it single is? But you know what it is?
It's Ice Cube's flow. And I get it. It's Ice all Cube's flow. All of a sudden, he sounds more we futuristic. Go from
these guys, ego tripping in a proper way, to
Eazy-E.
Eazy-E sticking his ding-a-ling-a-ling long into the back of her throat. And you're like, that is the least hard way I've ever heard anyone express that. Like,
but you know what? You know what? I think that's why he did that. I think whoever wrote the song or wrote that lyric or wrote that bar.
Oh, let's check the writers.
Please check it. But whoever wrote that bar did that for a reason. Either to make fun, either to laugh at Eazy saying it.
For sure.
Or, you know what? We are never going to forget that bar.
True.
You know what I mean? It's like it's kind of like one of those things.
So, just to put it into context, the DOC wrote Dre and Easy's verse. So the DOC wrote the ring, the ding-a-ling-a-ling. Come on, man! Don't call your dick a ding-a-ling. Like, if you're a gangsta, and you really are a gangsta, you're.
But I mean, you're talking to gangsters back in the 90s, in the 80s.
That's the original word for it, and we have just changed it and made it all weird. Imagine.
It's always been your ding-a-ling, baby. It's always meant penis.
I don't have a ding-a-ling.
It's like a 6-year-old way of saying it. Where did we come up with these? 6-year-olds came up with ding-a-ling as a way to say it, fuck. It's a kid word. It's not meant to be used in a gangster rap song.
Especially not one called Parental Discretion Is Advised.
Either way, fuck that song.
Oh my god. What did you give that song?
Look, it's well produced. Don't get me wrong, the beat's nice. And like, for that, as long as the song is well produced and well structured, it will at the very least get a 3. So I got a 3. Because it wasn't great. Ice Cube was great. The rest of it was okay. I did not like it. I'm happily never gonna listen to it again.
Wow, rough.
And you? What do you think?
Well, isn't that what Ren told me to be, bro?
It's true.
I gave it a 4.
Okay.
I like the way it was made.
Okay, whatever.
I like it was just another one of those I'm better, I'm doing this, I'm king shit song, and it just made me feel happy after a bad day.
Yeah, it's not the best song on this album, folks. It's like you can easily skip over this one.
Bonnie, please save the day.
Okay, so I gave it a 4/5 because overall it's a good song.
Yes!
It's a good song. I enjoyed the
Bonnie,
beat.
Bonnie, you're not allowed back on the
it
podcast.
It was jazzy and like fun and bluesy.
You can't
and
do that.
I liked the piano. I enjoyed all that. So that was good. DLC was good. Eazy-E's just, you know how he is. And like, but he's unique and you know when he's there, he just shows up and you're like, hey, it's him and whatever, let's go. And but for me, the biggest problem with this song was Dre. It just dragged the whole song down.
Dre did have a very long verse.
It was really, stood out for being so bad. So, like, I mean, he's not the Dre that I currently am exposed to and know.
And enjoy.
In this song only. I'm just going to say that.
Oh, my word. What did you give it again?
4/5.
Okay.
That's still a good song.
All right, all right.
Dre, it's really
his
point.
We could gladly just move on.
Okay, no. 8 Ball remix. Hook the right turn and let the boys go past. Then I say to myself, they can kiss my ass. Hit to get drunk, got the 8 in my lips. Apparently an 8 Ball is an old English 800, which appears to be a ghetto-ass looking type of beer that is apparently popular in the realm of Compton back in the era of, like, let's say, the mid-80s. And this happens to be the beverage Eazy-E enjoys cruising around Compton with whilst he drinks and drives and he gets into fights and is otherwise a useless degenerate.
So a really boring track of Eazy-E talking
like,
about how stupid he...
Like, listen, no, this is beer. Not, like, cruising down the street in his 6'4 and shit.
Nope.
This is, like... a song about him
being dumb.
He literally goes and buys beer at the store in the song. Like, that is a part of the verse because the song had nothing else to
do. Okay, no, hold on. Given the fact that it is storytelling, it's pretty cool, but you're saying
it's a whole story.
It's not even a children's story.
It's just a story of him causing trouble and, like, running around
and drinking and driving.
And
he just drinks and drives the whole.
He's
I'm drunk.
So
I'm an
cocky.
Asshole.
He's just so
I'll fight you
because
I'm an alcoholic. That's
he's like
all I heard.
He's like Napoleon. He He's like this little guy who wants to just fight everybody.
Napoleon wasn't actually short. It's just that people have really tall bodyguards to protect them. So in all the pictures where you see it, it looks like he's short, but he was actually taller than
me. I've seen him sitting on a horse. Anyways, he's short.
You're fired.
Nope.
Wrong.
No.
So fuck this song. It's
What did everybody give it?
I don't even know what I gave it.
I gave it a 4 on 5. I thought it was pretty good. I still enjoyed it.
Bonnie, you're
fired. I like Eazy-E. What can I say? As much as he's not a great rapper, he is captivating.
In the words of Eazy-E, do you want to fuck him? Because he wants to fuck you too. That was a Gangsta Gangsta.
Remember, he died because he got STDs. Because
that's what he does.
Yes. I can see why all the ladies or whoever was into him.
How? Does that voice attract you?
Yeah, but he's got that personality. Would you want that voice talking to you as like... He's like a strong little guy,
I hate to do this, but would you really enjoy having that voice talk to you while you're having...
I'm sure you get used
Bonnie,
to it.
Bonnie, oh my God. Would you like his ding-a-ling at the back of your throat? Jerry curls?
It was the Jerry curls. I don't like that fuck style.
Off. Hold on, she's throwing hints.
Did you give the song?
I gave it a 3 on 5.
Me too.
Very neutral.
I had a lot of trouble giving it a 3 on 5. I did it because it's well produced and it is okay for what it is, but goodness gracious, is it definitely my least favorite song I've heard so far.
Oh. Hmm. Okay.
Move on to something like that.
All right.
Getting respect in showbiz. Hey, yo, homeboy,
what's up?
Why don't you tell him what your name is?
Trey, the motherfucking doctor. Bitch hopper. The sucker motherfucker stopper.
I can tell you that this song was not written by Dr. Dre. He had no part of the lyrical writing. He was on the beat side of things. However, the way they delivered this track together, the way they just delivered both voices at the same time, doing the same full verse together, was really cool and not something I've seen a lot of in hip-hop. And
I like the distorted trumpets.
I like the whole fucking beat. I like
the funkiness is amazing.
The way they flow together is... you know what this song made me realize?
What?
This is where the classic Slim Shady Dr. Dre team-up shit got its foundation, man. Because if you look at Dre's career, he's always like that. He was bumping with fucking Ren. He was bumping with fucking Snoop Dogg. Even Kendrick. When he was fucking with Kendrick, he did it. It's cool. Dre, that is my favorite thing you've brought to music, is that every song you do that with them all. It's fucking cool.
He makes like these... He's got these iconic sounds that he uses. It's like... Throughout this entire album, I did pretty much assume that he... produced half the beats.
Well, he and DJ Yella collectively produced all the beats.
And I really enjoy how they kept it very funky, very groovy, and they were able to like
rap
hard bars on top of it. But groovy
it was really cool. I really like that.
I really think it's just amazing how they really bring the back and forth together. The way they rap, I've never heard two rappers do a whole verse at the same time together like that.
It was amazing.
It's a back and forth verse.
No. The first verse and the fourth verse is Dr. Dre and MC Ren at the same time doing the entire verse together.
The
same verse. Like, they're both, you hear it. One's got a deeper voice than the other one. You can hear it. It's not layered. Yeah. It's
I thought it was back to back.
There are parts of that where they do that, but there were entire verses where they're just together rapping it. It is really cool to me. I like the way it turned out.
It's like harmonizing in a way.
Yes.
With this shit, though, I give it a 4 on 5.
I give it a 4 on 5.
It is not quite the high-energy classic that I've come to love of NWA.
But you know what, though? That's what I liked about it. That's why.
But that's why it wasn't a 5 on 5, because it wasn't a true banger.
Why? In the middle is where the message is.
Go on, please. Elaborate, Bonnie.
The message... Okay, so I also just wanted to say that I really... You can feel it, and you just enjoy it. The connection and friendship... of MC Ren and Dr. Dre in this song, so I love that. I literally, in my notes, I wrote, they seem like pals with a little happy face. so I like that. Because a lot of the time people work together and they don't really connect. They just kind of work separately but together. But I like that these ones work together. Anyways, and so the whole message to me was that they just want people to do what they're doing, but make... original music like they're doing, just be better,
and
that's what they want. And so their message is just to strive and work harder and be better at what you're doing, and just don't think that because you're a rapper, you're automatically going to be rich and famous.
It's not like, so what I'm understanding is that it's not like they're saying that they're better, but that they want people to be better than them.
Yeah, they want something people to like be that. Better, yeah.
It sounds to me a little bit like all throughout that, it was really saying you should work to more efficiently express yourself.
Even if Yella makes it a cappella, I still express yo, I don't smoke weed or sex. Cause it's known to give a brother brain damage, and brain damage on the mic don't manage.
Hold on. Even if Yella drops it a cappella, Dr. J just wants to express that he does not, and I mean not, smoke cess, because smoking it will give you brain damage.
Yep.
And brain damage on the microphone is hard to manage. And then drop the chronic. 5 million records sold. I'm just like,
yep.
Look, when I first heard this song, right?
I was like, wait, what?
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 Genius.com. Like, smoke? Annotations. Dr. Dre did not smoke weed at this time. He got introduced to marijuana by Snoop Dogg later on and then turned into Dre. And apparently smokes it by the pound now, like Snoop Dogg. So either way, I just had to get that off my chest because...
But that gave that... It's interesting because there is a side of Dre that didn't smoke.
But that means he's like, he's being influential. He's realizing that he has... like strength behind his words, and that they can you know influence a lot of people.
The
and
only
so for
thing
him
I
being like,
say,
hey, don't do drugs, don't smoke weed, like be clean, like that's what he's saying in this message.
But look,
like, kind
keep
of
in
like,
mind that it's not really
it's a
Dre
good thing.
But Dre's not saying Dre's words, okay? Dre is just saying Ice Cube's words. And
Ice Cube wrote the verse.
Ice Cube wrote the song, because Dre is not a lyric writer. Like, he just didn't. Like, even Nothing But a G-Thang was written by the DOC and a few other people. Like, he just doesn't write the song. So, I appreciate it for what it is. I love the positive message of expressing yourself. This is the clean, radio-friendly mom song for NWA so that their grandmothers could bump a track and not hate it, right? That's what this is.
Maybe.
I really like it. It's the music video. This is a better music video. This is a music video that starts off with a fucking point with some slavery and shit going on, cotton fields.
Yeah.
Then NWA breaks through. Then they deal with shenanigans. They're in jail cells. They're all over.
There's just a lot going on in that video.
Well, it's kind of like the entire struggle to success, because at the end, he ends up being the president.
Which was
blah, blah,
amazing.
Blah. So it's like... And you know, Drake's started from the bottom.
Yeah.
It's basically that.
Except that Dre, not Drake, but Dre started from the bottom and then actually is there.
Yes.
And Drake kind of started in the middle and never quite got there.
Fair. But I'm just saying, like, when you watch the music video to express yourself, it kind of looks like, you know, you started from the bottom,
and
now you're,
you
aim to rise to presidency.
And it's like, it's just a whole song about being real and intelligence and keeping yourself calm and balanced and doing the right thing. It's literally what Bonnie described the last song as, only more direct and bluntly with less egotism.
Okay. Can I tell you my review of this little song?
Well, yeah.
Okay, so what happened is, so I really like the song. I love the use of Express Yourself. I'm giving it a 4 on 5, though, because as much as I love it and I, you know, it's really good, my issue is that they use the song Express Yourself, but their whole message is basically just like, don't do drugs, express yourself. And I'm just, I don't get, like, the correlation between the two messages.
I have a question. Where, besides the fact that Dre was like, I don't smoke cess,
where the fuck
where else was no drugs?
Is that, like, how is it you found profound meaning in, like, every other song?
Not to break it down, right? Not to break it down, but where?
Yeah, no, for real.
Give me the lyrics then, I'll tell you.
Okay, but for real, it's a great song. I gave it a 5 on 5.
It is a 5 on 5.
This is a song that makes me happy when I listen to it. Like, and you're just like, okay.
It makes you bob your head, and it makes you want to express yourself, and it's just, you're...
And it's very intelligently written, pushing a conscientious way of living.
He's just proving that he is practicing what he preaches, and I appreciate that.
Which well, then no, ironically because you have to turned take out it, to be the opposite.
Take, okay,
you have
but
to take
it in
consideration. Look where he was back then and what he aimed to be, and look where he is now and what he
but,
is.
But like, he was living the thug life, you know, he was gangster, gangster, and you know, he's in
where
all
he
these
is
things.
In 2017 is pretty irrelevant to where he was in 1987. That came next. But his whole point of this song was live right.
Yeah.
That's what I took from it. And
a lot
part
of positive
of that,
messages in this
well,
album.
I just really took it as just be yourself.
Just remember, Bonnie, this is America's most dangerous group.
Yeah, pretty scary.
With all the funky hip-hop beats.
Okay. When I saw a remix, I wasn't thrilled because the last remix was not thrilling for me.
Fair. Mm-hmm. I had the same opinion. Yeah. Although...
Where is the original song?
Probably like NWA and the Posse and prior. Like they did have a group album back in the day, like an EP of sorts. And they had singles at the time. This isn't like the first music they released.
Yeah.
This is the debut full-length album.
Hmm.
And so they remixed it and it was like amazing.
Oh yeah, and here to rock ya with some help from my homeboy E, the criminal of the ruthless posse, fucking it up, word up. It's... You know, I got like a cypher vibe off of it. It felt like a really long cypher through everybody.
If you think about it, it really shows how Dr. Dre and MC Ren were really good pals, and they bounced well off of each other.
Okay.
And it's true, though. They really great chemistry.
Not in this song.
What? I completely disagree with you.
What? No. Okay, no, hold on. I want an explanation.
First of all, 5-on-5, perfect fucking
yes,
track.
Yes, 5-on-5.
It.
Already.
It's amazing.
Please explain. Please destroy our hearts and explain it.
It's
like demons here all over again.
Oh, really, right? Really, right?
Hey. I'm my own person.
You could be.
Winning songs. Just...
So, this song was all just about them bragging about being like rich and famous and how they're worth something and it's really cool and whatever and that they're the originals from Compton.
Are they not?
Well, they are, you know, and it's cool that they can brag about it. But, you know, as I've said maybe once or twice before in my life, nobody likes a bragger.
Once or twice, like an hour.
Wait.
She really says that.
And you decided to date a rapper?
Okay, hold on. Let me finish up my little...
I do like to brag.
I'll tell you about this little song. So, so we got DJ Ren and his
MC Ren.
MC Ren. And his verse was long, and he's kind of boring. So was kind of long and boring.
She's throwing that shade.
And then
oh
Dre
my god!
Came, and then Dre came in, and then same kind of thing. So I gave it a 2-on-5 because it was boring.
Oh my god,
Yeah. And it's just more about Compton. Just being like, hey,
that's
we're from
point.
Compton again.
What's the name of the album? Straight Outta Compton. We had the whole conversation on how this all makes me want to baby, you're embarrassing me on public. Listen. Okay, we're moving on to a better thing. Moving away from Bonnie's awful
opinion.
Are you? I ain't the one.
No.
See, I'm only down for screwing, but you know. Gotta play it off cool, cause if they catch you slipping, you get schooled.
First thing
is a poo butt.
It's a butt full of poo.
Did nobody else like go, what the fuck's
wait,
a poo butt?
Did you write that? Did you write poo butt?
No,
it's the first lyric. I ain't the one. First of all, fuck like a poo butt.
Oh, and I never heard the poo butt. I heard like, I just thought it was two different words. I just kind of... No.
Yeah, no, I had to ask that. Okay, moving on to the
or
song.
Is it
anyways,
it's just... a poo butt.
Oh, but maybe he's brown nosing. Like,
anyway,
you know, trying to kiss
on,
ass.
Okay.
What did you guys think of that song, though, besides that?
I liked it. It is amazing.
Yeah, it's a great
it is
song.
Like, I ain't saying she a gold digger. But like in 1987 with better rhymes and a significantly more fun beat. Because
I think this is like the first
amazing.
Song on the album that was like, don't trust women.
Okay, but it's not don't trust women, actually.
He's like, don't trust women
look,
who won't sleep with you.
Listen, it's not it's not that. This guy, when I heard this song, I had this epiphany. I'm like, Ice Cube's telling every woman out there my dating strategy right now. This is not okay, right?
Yep.
So when I took her out on the first date, I had maximum budget in mind. $30. I'm not willing to spend more than $30 on a first date because we can't have fun on less than $30. Fuck you. Simple as that. Evidently, we had fun on $30. She's here. Believe it or not, we went to go play mini putt.
and we walked until 2 in the fucking morning.
Wow, we sat for a while.
And then kissed and shit. And then I took a taxi home and went to work the next day and suffered. And, well, it was worth it. But all I'm trying to say is I appreciate entirely the strategies delivering. It isn't just fuck a girl. It's if she won't fuck you if you're poor, fuck her. And I make money, but that doesn't mean I'm going to spend it on your damn haircut. That's just me.
And that's what the girls in this song want. They want their hair and their nails done.
So it's not...
And they're going up to Ice Cube being like, hey, boy, you got some money for me? And he's like, well... But
when it comes to sex, they have a cough.
Look,
Yeah.
The lifestyle that he chose to live is basically
but
what...
This is... Okay, this isn't the song about the lifestyle.
It's the song about the lifestyle.
This is the
song
about regular ass people.
Regular ass people that...
Yeah.
You know, he probably got cold.
No, man. We're talking about a particular type of girl, man.
This happens to people all the time.
Especially if you listen to other songs and they describe the type of environment they're in. This is just regular, man. This is most of the girls who go to the club still past the age of 25. This is any gold digger. This is anybody that's after money. You've never... there's actually a group of people who go around and they go on dates with guys like you and me. And I mean, we're not models. We're just people without lots of stacks. So we're average. And they go out for free fucking supper. They never plan on seeing you again. They just see a free meal in it.
Terrible.
And this has happened to all sorts of dudes. The amount of people who promise for drugs, for anything. And I'm not saying that guys aren't...
Just be honest.
I'm not saying that guys don't do their fair share of shit. But there is a particular type of women that constantly gets targeted in hip-hop, and it's not all women, and I think it's worth noting that this song is about a type of woman, and he kind of makes it clear, if you're down to ride when I'm broke, we good. Like, one of the lines is, I drive a fucking bucket. You can either get in or stay on the curb, but I'm going. And, like, I respect that. That Ice Cube can say he's a pimp, and I believe him. Whereas other guys...
Well, he ain't no sucker. I'll tell you that much.
Gotta be true to himself.
In modern rap, bro, if you throw $30,000 at a stripper, she's a prostitute, and you're being pimped, as was expressed on that Lupe Fiasco song that sounded like church music. But in this case, Ice Cube's clearly like, I got shit to do. You're with me to ride or not. I respect it. 5-on-5.
Flat out, 5-on-5. I felt the same way. It's like, it's the... 80s version of Ride or Die. Honestly, dude, good. I think that's for anybody, not just for girls. I think that's for like homies too and friends too and everything. Like,
it's a charitable message targeting.
I'm broke, but if you got my back, you got my back.
I believe Ice Cube is 100% like that. This song just happened to be about a particular subsect of that idea.
It was a fun song.
What did you give it?
I gave it 4-on-5.
Why?
I don't know, because I mean, like, it has to be, like, perfect, and I'm going to download it and listen to it forever and ever to be a 5-on-5.
That'll
five.
Generally never happen.
You gave
happen.
Fives to songs that did not deserve a five.
Well, that's my opinion. Somebody's got to like them.
Moving on to Dopeman.
Remix. She like his car, and he get with her. Got a
black eye, because the dope man hit her. Let that slide, and you pay it no mind. Just wasting your voice.
No, I'm not. I can go for hours.
Yeah, I know.
So, what do you guys think?
This is the best piece of journalism on the album.
Like, I have to agree.
It's pretty good.
Like,
very good.
I have met girls who have been strawberries, like, straight for crack. I have met people, and I've heard a lot of stories. And the way Ice Cube describes this particular type of crack dealer seems very apt, as I understand the situation, the types of people involved, etc., the mentalities behind it. I was just recently watching an Afro Man interview where he describes the type of women who become these types of girls. And it is quite interesting to see, like, the way he put it down. And keeping in mind, this was something that Ice Cube saw going on around him and described in perfect fucking detail.
Yeah.
And the way he puts the strawberries on blast, the way he's like, fucking don't smoke crack, it'll fuck your brain up. And then something just happens.
Hello, I'm Easy the Dope Man.
I'm like...
The usual famous engine.
But like, look,
like,
man.
Like, are you fucking serious, dude? Seriously? It's kind of like Ice Cube just full on went, don't do this, you fucking idiot. And then Easy's like, wait, guys. Wait. Do this. Do this now.
It's more like Easy's going, I'm that fucker.
Yeah, he's admitting to it. He's admitting that he's like...
I wonder if they beefed over that track.
He's just a troublemaker. He's an asshole. He's just, you don't get high off your own supply, right?
Which is a fair rule.
Yeah, Biggie stated that in the Ten Crack Commandments.
Can I just say, I may not be the biggest, like, person with, like, all this knowledge and stuff about rap, but was this not a little bit like Slick Rick at the very beginning?
Which song?
You listen to Slick Rick?
Well, doesn't he sing a song about a dope guy?
Well, no, he sings, no. He sings about Stick for This. Is when the kid shoots at the cop and runs away, and he runs into an abandoned place, and he cocks through a door, and he goes, what do I see? Hey, it's Dave, the dope man shooting up dope, da-da-da-da-da-da. And then he's like, I need bullets. And then Dope Man Dave gives him the bullets, and then, you know, he stands off with the cops and shit.
You got me.
I get where she's going, but, I mean, she's slightly still wrong, because it's not about dope dealer.
I am still slightly wrong, but they're both singing about dope.
Dope Man is about the psychological profiling of a particular types of character, such as... but also the hoes involved in this.
Okay, I didn't catch that, though.
Like, literally the last line of the second verse is, for those of you who don't get it, this guy.
Sorry.
A strawberry is a girl who trades pussy for crack. Dope, man, dope. And then, either way, I really like this song. I also want to say that at the very end, the Mexican guy. Is a Mexican guy named Crazy D. It's not like fake or anything. It's a Mexican guy coming on, and he's just like, listen, you sold crack to my sister, and if she dies, I'm gonna fucking kill you.
Strong message.
And I think that is a well-rounded and
I like the way they did it. He has the little, like, the little flair to it. It's a little song.
I just wanted to, like, make it clear. It's not actually racist if a Mexican came in and did it because he wanted to bring that flair to it. Like,
no, that's fine.
Just put in it. Because there was some speculation on the nets that Eazy-E may have been this Mexican impersonator. But nope. It's Crazy D. Not Eazy-E. Crazy D. Fuck off, man. These fucking names.
All right, Bonnie, what did you give the song?
I gave it a 4.5 on 5. I thought that it was a very good song. It had a really good message to, like, stay clean. And I thought it was also kind of like a public message to the people of Compton to just be better. And also to maybe all people in similar lifestyles and, like, situations. So I think that he just wants everybody to be better.
And then Eazy.
He's the example of what not to be.
I don't agree with that. Eazy does come in from a sense of knowledge. He's not like
a poser. But he's the reality.
No, he's not a poser.
But what I mean is he's not glorifying it. He's just I'm Eazy, this guy.
This is my life.
This is what it is. And as much as I think about it, it's funny to me how Eazy-E pops in right after Ice Cube puts on this barrage, but it fits the whole lieu of the song and the way that it ends with the Mexican guy.
Yeah.
Fair enough. I give it a 4 on 5.
Bro, this song's perfect. This song is fucking perfect.
I give it a 4 on 5.
Quite on the set.
It's gangsta code killing. You want to know what it means? Definition, villain. With the stupid dope rhymes. And once you hear one line, you can tell it's mine.
I don't think is a word. Quite on the set. Once again, we've got
some grammatical issues, but no, that's okay. This song was bland. This song was like steak with no seasoning. It had all the right...
Steak?
With no seasoning.
No.
So bland steak. It could be a good piece of meat, but it needs a little bit of something to give it a little flair, right? And so I felt like it had everything it was supposed to have, like a beat and a rapper who knows how to rap.
It's MC Ren the entire way through. It's how he wants quiet on this set and everything, and how it's a full song of
him. It's basically his other ego track on the album that turned out to be a lot more boring than the other one. And I did not really fucking like this song, to be honest. This was a 3 on 5. It was boring. It was okay. It was just whatever.
Yeah.
It wasn't bad to me. Don't get me wrong. It's still like a well-rounded song. And I can see how if you're not into the same shit I'm into, you could like it. It's just not my cut. It's like a steak with no seasoning.
I gave it a 4. I liked it. I just liked his rhyme schemes and the patterns he did. I mean, it was a little bit wonky at first, and then I listened to it the entire week, and I was like, no, I can actually get into it. One, no,
I don't
like it. So you got it.
It's on the album. There shouldn't be any wonkiness to get past.
That's not entirely true. We've been reviewing some albums on both Headspace and the Classic Quest.
There's some wonkiness that works.
Oh yeah, I know. But that's why
I just felt that this wasn't wonky. It was boring. It was bland. It was a 3 on 5. I felt nothing.
Yep.
What about you?
1 on 5. It was boring. So boring. I literally just wrote MC
Ren. I don't think
I've
given
MC
a 1
Ren.
Since we started the Classic
Bonnie,
Quest.
You can't. What,
listen,
really?
Listen. MC Ren pretty much did the whole thing, and he's boring, so it was long and boring, and it just didn't stop, so it was just boring. One.
It.
If
makes
I never
sense.
Heard it again, I
That makes
be...
sense. It's a fair assessment.
Yeah.
All right, and you? 4 on 5. I gave it a 3 on 5. This is the lowest song on the album. Folks, apparently we as the Classic Quest crew at Plus Bonnie don't want you to listen to this song. Well, Chris does. Fuck
yeah,
him.
Don't waste your time.
Don't listen to Chris.
Yeah, it's okay.
All right, there's one
But you
more.
Know what?
There's one more song left because we're finished talking about that song.
Yeah, give me something to dance to.
Arabian Prince, back with a style of hype. Not slow and low, it's the fast type. Getting dumb, can you hit a drum?
Yo, Dre, why don't you pump it up some?
Okay, Bonnie, can you...
Did they say Little Cut? Who's that?
No. Who the fuck is Arabian Prince?
I don't know, but he's back with the fire bars.
He's just here.
When was he gone?
Look, this is what we were saying earlier. Who the fuck is Arabian Prince? Now, I'm sure that real hip-hop heads who know about this, guys older than me, are going to be killing me if this ever gets famous. In the meantime, who the fuck is this guy? Why is he just not there? He's not on... Is he the sixth guy on the album cover? Because there were 6 on the album cover, not just 5, and I was trying to figure this out.
It's not the DLC?
It could be the DOC, because the DOC was running with them at one point as well.
And the DOC can do it better.
It's probably me.
Of course it is.
I'm pretty sure I took that picture a while ago.
It's true.
Yeah.
She's the one on the left.
It's me. The one next to...
What did you guys think of how they bounced off each other and how fun was this song?
First of all, the entire beat just had me bopping. The entire way
it's not, like, it's not hip hop. Now we're like doing dorky white guy moves.
Like,
but you know what? But you know
music.
It's not even techno
music. But Drake
music.
Comes from that, right? This is like Dre's beginnings of his career was
well,
in
I mean,
a group like this.
It does sound in like parts of it. It does sound
it
like
is
today's
the
music. Even
80s. All
but
I felt
it
was
it has a very 80s feel.
This is like the 80s my mom would have listened to at the whatever club was around back then.
If you
then.
Can do like crazy footwork and stuff like that and like popping and bopping or whatever.
Like, speaking
then
of which,
this
did anyone else
song.
Notice that it took only a minute for Eazy-E to get tired and say we need to take a break?
Yeah, there's too many of the dope man.
You'd figure a guy would need a little more stamina than that to run from the police, especially if he's loudly professing things like, fuck the police, yeah, I said it with authority, or is that a
No, that's
one?
Ren.
Fuck off.
That's Ren. Well, you know, seriously, why am I remembering all this shit?
Because there's a lot to remember. That's my answer. Push goes to shove.
This
is
a really great
a
song.
A really great way to end the album. And unlike how Public Enemy did it last time, and I didn't like how it was done, your logic on it's a good break from the intensity and it lets you kind of wind down is done right here. It's fun. It's so cool.
But You know what? I want to defend Public Enemy for a minute.
Why?
Because listen.
She did not like Public Enemy.
Hold on. Given their album and how they're preaching and what they're specifically talking about, is a little different than what I find NWA is talking about. Hold on, wait. I get it that Ice Cube is like a little bit onto the, you know, racial
side.
I think
it's more what they do outside of the music that's different. But I have to say that the music videos felt like they lined up with the way Chuck D was squeezing police in, the way Slick Rick was. There was a lot of politics in that album. It's just that then you know who the fuck they are when they left the studio and what their legacy is after the fact. Whereas we know that Public Enemy never stopped being activist and never stopped pushing it. Either way, I want to say this song is a 4 on 5. It is fucking a funky, fresh, song of the era.
For sure.
And I can tell you, it made me want to dance.
It did. I was dancing on the way to work.
So I thought it was a 3 on 5.
Oh my god, she gave it a chromite. She's never allowed back on the podcast. I'm saying this right now.
I have to say, she dissects songs in a more fun way than you, sir.
I agree, but
shade
some
throwing.
Songs that should be good ratings, she's...
That's okay.
You know what?
Okay.
I appreciate her perspective, okay? After the podcast, we can talk some shade. We'll throw it all around.
There'll be no shade, just sunny days.
Okay,
so hold on. So I gave it a 3 out of 5. I thought it was good. If you wanted to, like, kind of, like, bop your head a bit, it was fine. It wasn't, like, the danciest song, and it felt just so weird, like a really weird ending for me to such a hard, oh, we're so badass and gangster.
Wait.
Hold on a second.
I want to quote some.
Bonnie did not watch The Last Classic Quest, but that sounds really fucking familiar, doesn't it? That is, like, almost word for word how I described my feelings about the last song on the Public Enemy album. It was almost...
Wait, I just want to clarify something. Bonnie, didn't you say somewhere in the album that you were like, okay, we get it, you know, you're a badass, we don't need to do this, and nah. And for me, that kind of feels like maybe you wanted a nice track to listen to.
Well,
wait. And then they give you the nice track, and you're like, well, this is a really bad ending to a really hard album. Because, you know, this is not what they are. They're gangsters, and now they're all dancing. And it's
what,
like,
prejudice is,
but
this?
But didn't it's you not, want a nice track?
It's not prejudice. It's like, if you want to make a nice, happy song, put that on a whole different album.
Okay.
Or
no,
something.
Actually,
or
okay,
release that by
yourself. No,
you. This,
no,
it just didn't feel like
no, no, no. Now, okay, listen. For quick little thing 101. You need different vibes on
I
an
totally
album.
See what happens
that.
Often. See what happens often, Bonnie, is that Chris gets
emotions.
This lecture, and now he's trying to dish it out to you, and he's going in hard. That's my lady you talking about.
Oh, now
no,
again,
no,
personal.
It I
want to
hear it.
It's cool.
This album, let's talk about the album, is a classic. For me, at least. Based on that thing, 4.0 being a classic and up, this is the highest one I've rated on the Classic Quest so far. It's a 4.3. Granted, it's 4 albums. I'm hoping to be 4.3, but it's fucking great. There's maybe 2 songs I don't really want to ever hear again. The rest of it is, like, amazing, and I feel like I've evolved as a rapper listening to this.
Bonnie, what did you think?
My overall rating was 3.69. And that's like a 74%. And
that's,
I mean,
not a classic rating, though.
No, she clearly didn't find it to be a classic.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I thought it was really good. It definitely, I mean, I do think it
no,
is
it's
a classic.
A good album.
It's got a lot of
no,
great
a classic
songs.
Is 4.0, Bonnie. Yeah. You didn't make it a
classic.
Classic
is 4.0. I got screwed on that, too.
What did you give it?
I gave it a 4.1. I got a 4.1. I feel that the album itself is really great. And
just so that you guys know, Chris systematically calculated
that.
Wait.
I also want to point something else, too. As you guys have been following, and I never really listened to the old school hip-hop before. So coming from me as well, who's into the hip-hop game and wanting to be an artist and all this stuff, it is very, very, very... mandatory that you listen to this album.
Yeah,
that's true.
It is. You know, there's Slick Rick you got to listen to. There's
is
all of them,
though.
But you have to
like,
listen to this album.
Everybody has to understand one thing: the significance of this album is so paramount. It birthed gangster rap in a very public and mainstream way.
Not just
way.
That. I think that because they're still
West
around,
Coast rap
because
to
there's at least like
well,
two of the main guys are still around. Like,
to me, that's not necessarily quite as relevant because you could look at a lot of acts and be like, look, Method Man's still around, Wu Tang, no. Yes, they're significant, but the significance of Straight Outta Compton is paramount. And y'all should go check out the movie to get a little bit of an idea of what it is.
Yeah, movie's really good.
I digress. Yo. We've been going on forever. I'm sure they're like, fuck, they brought in a girl and it took twice as long.
Sorry.
I think y'all should check it out. Remember, like the video, subscribe to the channel,
hit the comments.
We appreciate it when you correct us because we can grow that way.
You mean correct these guys?
Don't want to get corrected.
Twitter is all that shit.
I expect all the correcting.
All right, peace and love, folks. Happy weekend.
Have a good one, guys.
Bye.